going. All right, so thank you all for being here and braving the cold. I don't know about you, but I'm here because I believe health care is a human right. Yeah! You believe health care is a human right.
Yeah!
Yes! You believe that every man, woman, and child should have the right to health care from the moment they are born?
Yeah!
Are you here to stand and tell your government that we want health care and we want it now?
Yeah!
I like it.
More of it.
If you got sons, I mean, hold them up high. Be proud because we are here to send a message. This is our first stand, and it is certainly not our last stand. Today we have a whole bunch of great speakers for you. Accidents, doctors, people from healthcare organizations. And so we're going to get that rolling. I appreciate everybody's patience. First up for you, we're going to have Sophie Harnish, and she is from the Olympia Free Clinic, which is an amazing organization that provides healthcare services to people who normally wouldn't get it. So, Sophie, whenever you're ready, please give her a warm welcome.
Yeah! What's her name? Sophie Harnish. Sophie Harnish, okay.
Here in the cold. To protect the health of our community, and thank you to our revolution for organizing this demonstration. So, as Eric mentioned, I'm Sophie. I'm the program coordinator for the Olympia Free Clinic, where we offer uninsured and underinsured adult community members with coordinated mental health and medical services. Since opening in 2011, we have provided thousands of exams and sessions. In my position, I have the unique opportunity to view the ways in which our system is still failing. We see those who can't afford their copays, immigrants, both undocumented and documented, who are unable to get insurance, and those whose conditions, either physical, social, or mental health, make it impossible for them to navigate the system and access care through traditional routes. I am in awe of our patients' humor, strength, and ability to survive tough circumstances. It is immeasurable. The Affordable Care Act has been an enormous step in the right direction. I have seen people with substance use issues actually able to get into treatment and recover from their disorders. I have seen people with hepatitis C able to access specialty care and find a cure. I have seen people with cancer, diabetes, schizophrenia, bipolar, all able to find care through access. But of course, even with the Affordable Care Act, we have so much work to do. We need to work on creating parity between medical and mental health services. We need to design systems actually around the needs of our most vulnerable community members. We need to step forward, not backwards, and we must all work together to protect the health of our communities. This is of absolute importance. We all agree that human rights are what we're here for, and that healthcare is a human right. So, let's hold each other's hands and ask our representatives to protect the health of Washington State community members.
Let's give it up one more time for Sophie and the Olympia Free Clinic. So, next up, I'm pretty happy to introduce to you a good friend of mine. His name is Adair Schmidt. He was a national Bernie delegate, and he's a longtime activist for human rights, social justice, and healthcare. So please give him a very warm welcome.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to try really hard to live up to that wonderful introduction that I was just given. But as I stand here today, and I look out at all of you, I remember that we do not leave the most vulnerable in our communities alone, that we do not allow those who would feel that taking away health care from people that need it, that a pre-existing condition should not be a death sentence, that every single person born in this country or not deserves the right to see a physician when they are sick, to get mental health care, to have their medication given to them. That is your right as a person. I stand here and I look out at all of you and I realize that we are not alone. That the ACA was a great stride forward, but there's more work to be done, that we will tell those in power that they will not take this from us, but they will expand it. We will not go from mandatory health insurance, but to free single-payer health care. When you are sick, you will be taken care of. When your children are sick, they will be taken care of. When your parents are sick, they will be taken care of. We will not let anybody sit out and have to suffer. We will not GoFundMe to get money for surgeries. We will not raise GoFundMe so that way someone can get life-saving medication. We will not leave anybody behind. And that is what we are here to promise you today.
Maybe he should be emceeing. I don't know. So next we have a very special person. Jamie is here with us, and she is from NAMI, which is the National Alliance of Mental Illness, and she is the vice president for the Thurston and Mason County chapters. Am I right? Oh, and they do a lot of great work. So as you've all been doing great at welcoming everybody, let's continue that for Jamie right now.
I can say that without hesitation that I would not be alive today if I didn't have the privilege of receiving excellent mental health care. But mental health care should be a privilege. It should be a right for all of us. I have to also acknowledge the incredible support that I have received from NAMI, helping me to discover hope and to fill my life with experiences that have tremendous meaning to me, including talking through good news today. NAMI is the nation's largest grassroots mental health organization, providing classes, support groups, and community education programs at no cost in 23 communities across Washington State, and is led by our NAMI Washington State office. Even with the Affordable Care Act, which as we all know provides access for health care coverage to everyone, NAMI programs still fill gaps in mental health care as our nation and our state system for care for people living with mental illness continues to be woefully underfunded and difficult to access due to a lack of mental health providers. NAMI wants to make sure we keep what works and make it better. The Affordable Care works and it saves lives. About 60 million children and adults in America live with a mental health condition. Even with the Affordable Care Act, 50% of people with mental illness do not receive care. In Washington, that percentage is closer to 60%. In Washington, there are over 2.8 million people with health care coverage through Medicaid, Medicare, and the Affordable Care Act. We need to protect our children. 3 out of 4 people who live with a mental health condition have symptoms by the age of 24. Approximately 57,000 adolescents in Washington experience a serious mental health illness each year. Our youth need consistent health care coverage so that if a mental health condition begins to emerge, we have access to services and support early before their condition worsens and becomes hard to treat. We need to protect our veterans. About 1 in 5 veterans returning from Iraq and Afghanistan, and 30% of Vietnam veterans have PTSD. Each day, an average of 20 veterans dies by suicide. Veterans' health care is a public trust and a national responsibility. Nearly 9 million veterans receive care from the VA. The VA spends $1.8 billion on research each year, including mental health conditions. VA mental health providers are experts in military culture and are the best providers to deliver culturally competent and evidence-based care to our active duty personnel and our veterans. keep what works and make it better by preserving and improving the VA healthcare system and the Veterans Choice Program, not by privatizing it. We need to invest in mental health services through Medicaid. Over 1.5 million individuals in Washington are enrolled in Medicaid through the Affordable Care Act. Medicaid expansion has removed barriers by allowing people to qualify based on income rather than disability determination. Currently, over 1 in 4 people who receive SSI or SSI payments are on disability as a result of a mental illness.
Hello.
Medicaid expansion has created a path to work and self-sufficiency and must be protected. The proposal to return Medicaid funding to block grants and or per capita cap for weak state programs with significantly less funding, dampening innovation, and putting people with mental illness at risk. Stable Medicaid funding allows states to provide consistent mental health care, lower costs, and improve outcomes. The impact of not receiving mental health care will shift those costs to other more expensive systems, like hospitals, emergency rooms, jails, and prisons. In order to save lives lost to mental illness, we must invest in and protect the following. Prevention through early intervention and access to quality care. Keeping people with mental illness out of our jails and prisons. And ensuring funding to support a quality, comprehensive mental health care system. Our state legislators and leaders have made significant investments to improve mental health services, and we still have a long way to go. Remember, keep what works and make it better. We must maintain access to expanded Medicaid eligibility. Required essential health benefits in the Affordable Care Act, including mental health services. Parity protections for mental health care. Coverage for people with pre-existing conditions without waiting periods or the ability to refuse to insure. Finally, some action steps you can take. Stay informed. Call your senators and representatives and tell them hands off the Affordable Care Act. Call your state senators and representatives and tell them to preserve access to expanded Medicaid eligibility in Washington at all costs. Join NAMI Washington on February 20th for our Lobby Day in Olympia and join NAMI's efforts to protect coverage of mental health treatment and provide education about mental health issues throughout our state. Thank you for being here today. Don't be silent. Continue to fight for your right to health care.
I like that. Don't be silent, right?
Right, yeah.
I said, don't be silent. So sometimes I got to do the boring stuff. We got an announcement. So they will be coming through with de-icing. And when they come to your section, if you would please get out of the way, that would be awesome. We can cheer about that too, right? We're out here. So next up for you, we have Jessica Blos, and she is a local activist and leader. She is also a licensed mental health provider and a substance abuse counselor. So let's continue on rolling in these warm welcomes and get as loud as we can. Why don't we?
Hey everyone, I'm Jessica, and like you said, I'm a mental health and substance use counselor here in the state of Washington. And I'm also here today to talk about how repealing the Affordable Care Act will be totally catastrophic for the behavioral health care industry in Washington State and across the country. Of all the changes that the Affordable Care Act had brought to the American healthcare industry, none has been greater than the revolution that has occurred with behavioral health care. The Affordable Care Act brought mental health and substance use disorder treatment and funding parity with other healthcare conditions for the first time in our American history. Do you want to know how much it expanded things? Did you know that right now more than 25% of all Medicaid spending goes towards the treatment of behavioral health conditions? Did you also know that the Affordable Care Act made mental health and substance use disorder services a standard part of essential benefits for individuals purchasing coverage? This means that for all plans sold through the health insurance marketplace, as well as most individual and small employer plans, they have to cover mental health services. This means that insurance companies cannot carve out mental health and substance use treatment from coverage. Prior to the Affordable Care Act, 18% of people who bought their own insurance did not have mental health care coverage. More than one-third of individuals with substance use disorder did not have coverage because insurance companies prior to this were never forced to offer coverage for it. Did you know that several of the Republican proposals for the Affordable Care Act would get rid of the stipulation that all plans cover mental health care in the first place? Also, did you know that the Affordable Care Act right now requires most health insurance companies to cover preventative services, which includes things like depression screenings and behavioral health services at no extra cost? The Health and Human Services Department has provided over $94 million in grants through the Affordable Care Act for free clinics to do screenings and to treat patients for substance use disorders. With the potential for repeal, these long-term survival of these programs is now in question. Did you also know that the ACA prohibits insurance companies from denying coverage to those with pre-existing conditions, including mental health? Did you know that prior to the Affordable Care Act, behavioral health disorders were the second most common pre-existing condition that insurance companies would use to charge people more for plans or to deny them coverage? Did you also know that 80% of all substance use disorder clients in King County right now utilize Medicaid expansion to pay for their treatment? So if the Affordable Care Act goes away, what is going to happen to all of our neighbors? Prior to the Affordable Care Act, insurers would use a wide array of practices to deny, delay, and discourage the use of mental health treatment. If the Affordable Care Act is repealed, what is going to happen to the tens of millions of Americans who need treatment for things like addiction, depression, and other various mental health conditions? At a time when the opioid epidemic has reached crisis-like proportions to become the leading cause of preventable death in America, killing more people than car accidents, and with suicide rates in America being at a 30-year high, how can we afford to cut back now? For mental health and substance use disorder professionals, people working in the field, the concern is massive. Should mental health care become unaffordable for people, they will put off going to their doctors until they are further along in their illnesses. And also, for people with depression and addiction, this can be deadly. Individuals with behavioral health disorders are the most disrespected, underfunded, and stigmatized individuals who seek chronic treatment or treatment for their chronic illness. These individuals are not strangers to us. They are our parents, our siblings, our partners, our children. They are our friends, our coworkers, our neighbors, and more importantly, they are us. They deserve our love.
Stay here.
They deserve our support. This is your and they deserve our respect.
Yeah.
With treatment, people with behavioral health can and do recover. We cannot afford to allow a backslide to occur when it comes to funding behavioral health care. We need to stand up and fight for the dignity and the wellness of others. So I ask all of you on the eve of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day to look into your hearts, your minds, and your souls and ask what you can do to help prevent this catastrophe. And if you can reach out to your elected officials to ask them this, and this is a quote from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Expediency asks the question, is it politic? Vanity asks the question, is it popular? But conscience asks the question, is it right? And there comes a time where we have to take a position that is neither safe, nor politic, nor popular, but we must make the decision because it is right. So I ask you all to think about what is right and what we can do for our community to protect everyone and not repeal the Affordable Health Care Act. Thank you.
How's everybody feeling? Do we still think healthcare is a human right? Yeah! Are we still going to fight to make sure that everybody's going to get the healthcare that they deserve? Yeah! So, a quick few things. If you're looking to get involved, we've got people over here doing some signups. And there's also a website that the organizer of this event has created, savehealthcare.us. Savehealthcare.us. I got that right? He made sure that I didn't say .com because it's .us. So next up for you is a friend of mine. His name is Clay Johnson. He is a local advocate for single payer health care and allocated taxes. And he's got aspirations to be a state senator someday. So warm welcome for Clay.
Good afternoon. My name is Clay Johnson, and in 2018, I intend to become Washington's next national senator. Today, I've got 15 minutes to explain to you why single-payer health care is needed. Not only that, why it's deserved. And finally, why we should fund it regardless of how much it costs. Raise your hand if you've ever experienced a traumatic event which left you with a crippling amount of debt, even if you were able to pay for it. Quite a number of you. All right, keep your hand up if your insurance company took care of the entire bill for you. Quite a number of them. The moral of the story here is that nobody should have put their hands down. Nobody. I'm going to tell you some facts, and I'll begin with explaining who did the research. The Kaiser Family Foundation is an American, nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that has roots in gathering healthcare data and analyzing it. Research from the Kaiser Family Foundation in 2015 found that a decade ago, only 55% of health plans had a deductible. Today, 81% do. Besides that, only 24% of workers were in a high deductible plan. These plans required that these workers pay more than $1,300 out of pocket before their insurance starts to cover them. Workers right now pay an average of $1,318 out of pocket before any deductibles are met. Families in high deductible plans must pay more than $2,600 out of pocket, with the average being $4,332. And that's according to the Kaiser Family Foundation. Now, raise your hand if you've always paid into health insurance, but you have not exceeded the deductible for many years. Too many of us. So put your hands down if you have never been sick or needed medicine while you've been paying for that insurance. See, we need a system where your insurance fully covers you without a deductible. Corporations like Cigna have a duty to their shareholders, that duty being to make as much money as possible. And they will decide the level of care that you receive based on your ability to pay. If you get hospitalized, they might cover some aspects of it. It depends on the certain types of conditions that you have and the symptoms that you present. I believe we need a system where our children don't need to deal with a harsh ear infections because we see it as too expensive or to see a pediatrician or to even fill the prescriptions themselves. If we're going to say that healthcare is a right, if we're going to have a single-payer healthcare system, it's going to mean paying for people who are sick or ill because of their chosen lifestyle, such as obesity problems or addictions. It's also going to mean paying for people who don't choose that same lifestyle, people with Parkinson's disease, for example, or Down syndrome. It's going to mean raising enough money to make sure that they get the best care they can possibly get whenever they need it. To borrow a line from John Q, sick, help. It's that simple. This kind of money will not be described as cheap, and comparatively, it could be one of the most expensive programs the government issues. When we start looking at costs in the billions, maybe even trillions of dollars, we have to remember what we're buying with our taxes, a government that works for the people, not against us. The CEOs of some of the largest health insurance agencies receive ludicrous amounts of wealth. In 2015, David Cordani of Cigna reported total compensation of $17.3 million. Even if you taxed that $17.3 million at 90%, David would still be taking home $1.7 million, and that's assuming that there weren't any tax loopholes for them to abuse. $1.7 million is a far cry more than many of us have. It is not a crime to earn millions of dollars. What is a crime is the level of health care coverage the average American currently receives. Not only that, our veterans, our disabled, and our elderly are all too often subject to even worse conditions, right here, every day in America. Americans paid $949 billion in premiums and $325 billion for out-of-pocket expenses, according to the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. If we use Bernie Sanders' healthcare model that he presented when he was running for president, we would be able to raise roughly $675 billion of that $1.274 trillion, so roughly half. Now, if we were to substitute health insurance premiums with a tax, we gain access to a much wider pool of resources, stabilizing the overall cost of dramatic procedures such as open heart surgeries. We would also need to pay for people who were not getting these sorts of surgeries when they were on their own plans because they couldn't afford it. That's going to be something that we all have to pay for under a single-payer healthcare system. Negotiating drug prices is another avenue that we should be traveling. And unfortunately, our own Senators Patty Murray and Maria Cantwell voted no against a bill proposed by Bernie Sanders that would reduce the cost of drug prices by importing them from Canada. If we bought many of the same drugs that we take now from Canada, we would save millions of dollars. Better yet, if the government were able to directly negotiate drug prices, we would be able to pay for them under our current system much more affordably. These taxes would have the insurance benefit. You won't always need it, but when you do need it, it will be there for you, something that cannot be said under our current system of healthcare. The point is this, don't let the daunting costs of healthcare scare you. We spent well over $5 trillion in our wars in the Middle Eastern areas. It's time to spend our tax dollars on ourselves here at home. We need to call on our representatives to not only fully fund a single-payer healthcare system, but also make sure that our colleges and universities are turning out top-quality doctors and nurses. In order to have effective and efficient healthcare, it will require having a saturated market of knowledgeable professionals who aren't corrupted by conflicts of interest when they're diagnosing your illnesses or prescribing your medications. Those medications need to be paid for by somebody who can afford them, Uncle Sam, who we've been paying for with our taxes. These drug prices have skyrocketed for years. Raise your hands if you have ever had need of an EpiPen. So roughly about 30 of us. These drug prices have seen an over 600% increase in price from a decade ago. That's something we can't afford with all the other costs that we have. And this is at the same time that Heather Bresch, the CEO of Mylan, whose salary started at $9 million in 2012, ballooned to over $18 million in 2016. You can't tell me that there is no correlation between her salary and those drug prices rising. In this vein, I publicly call on Senators Patty Murray and Maria Cantwell, as well as Representative Denny Heck, to be staunch supporters of a single-payer system not tormented with partisan politics. Americans deserve so much more than what we currently have in the way of health care, and we need representatives who will make it so. If they choose not to represent us, but rather their donors, they need to find another job. How can any of us expect Patty Murray to give a damn about our health care when she's taken over $475,000 from the pharmaceutical industry? Thank you, demand better representation when we're being taxed. We started a revolutionary war over it once, and we built a great nation because of it. We can do it again if they choose not to hear us. Today, we stand for affordable health care for every American citizen. My name's Clay Johnson. Thank you for joining me and millions of people across the nation today in doing this.
Uh-oh. It jumped at me. Oh, all right, so I just want to remind everybody that it is really cold, and so if you see somebody next to you and you might have an extra scarf or an extra pair of gloves, let's make sure that we're being neighborly to each other and helping each other out. And you can go inside if you're getting too cold. The doors are open up there, so you can warm up real quick. I'm pretty sure you can still hear the speakers. So next up, we have Gabe Shelton. He's here to share a story about his family's experience with health insurance. Gabe, want to go ahead and tell them what's going on?
My name's Gabe. I'm an organizer with Socialist Alternative here in Olympia, and I want to share a story about my family. In 2010, my uncle in Kansas was diagnosed with cancer. Through the treatments, he lost his job, and with that, he lost his health care. At that time, which was before the ACA was passed, he tried to get new insurance, but they wouldn't cover his cancer, because it was a pre-existing condition. What kind of crap is that? In 2011, my uncle passed away because he couldn't afford health care. My aunt went bankrupt. They sold their house that they had owned for 25 years, 5 years away from paying off the mortgage, and they had to sell it to pay for health care that wasn't even good enough. Do we want to go back to that?
No!
Do we want to go back to people dying from not paying for healthcare? No! The ACA is good. It's not good enough, but we have it right now, and we need to protect it. It is absolutely appalling that in this country, people die because they can't afford healthcare. As we know, we're the richest country in the world. We can afford it. We need to stand up and hold our representatives' feet to the flames and tell them to protect the Affordable Care Act and take it one step further for universal health care. When they say, how are we going to pay for that? Tell them, no more wars, no more militarized police, tax the hell out of the billionaires. Health care is a human right, no more deaths from lack of money. This is crap. Let's stand together and save our health care. Thank you.
I'm cold. Do I have a neighbor who has extra gloves? I'm just playing. I was trying to be funny. Thank you. Thank you. All right. So next up, we have Jesse Simmons. And Jesse is an advocate for single payer healthcare. And so he's going to come up and speak a little bit about that. And I hope you all give Jesse a big warm welcome.
Good afternoon, everybody. I just want to say, wow, this warms my heart. I'm a U.S. Army veteran who has made this community my home. And to see so many people turn out for this, it really touches me. All right, so for those who don't know me, my name is Jesse Simmons. I got involved in Thurston County politics over the last summer. I was a campaign manager candidate. I'm here today because I believe that access to affordable and adequate health care is a human right. I'm here because my 8 years of military service has taught me at least one thing, and that is the fact that we are only as strong as our weakest soldier, that we are only as great as the least of us, that we should never leave anyone behind.
All right, cool.
So
that way we can...
Truly, the issue of healthcare comes down to one basic sentiment. That is, either you care about human dignity and the value of human life, or you don't. That is why I believe the best solution to the issue of universal healthcare is a single-payer system at the state level. Under a single-payer healthcare system, healthcare can be financed in a way that benefits all of us. We will all pay into a system managed by one governing body. We will no longer line the pockets of insurance company executives, and we will no longer waste money that should go to our care. We will all participate in decisions that affect our health care. Single payer takes the power from insurance companies and puts it in the hands of the democratically elected representatives. Healthcare companies will no longer set the prices for care and the limitations on who can receive care. Under a single payer system, everyone has access to high quality health care. Single payer eliminates financial barriers and promotes equity in the healthcare system. It will drastically improve freedom of choice. You will be able to choose where to get healthcare and when to get it. I am confident that nobody in this crowd will be satisfied with leaving their fellow Washingtonians behind. I am confident that this crowd represents a majority of citizens across this nation who care about human dignity and believe in the value of a healthy and fulfilling life. I urge you to contribute to this fight in any way possible. I will be involved in the next few weeks at the ground level in fighting this fight against the Trump agenda. So I want you to contact me after this event if you have any questions. Thank you for listening to me speak and giving me the chance to do this. Thank you.
All right, so you guys want to wave to our friends over here that couldn't, you know, they're out in the sun? Everybody out in the sun, you want to wave to the people on the steps? So let's try something. I'm kind of making this up, so I don't know how useful it is. But you guys out there in the sun, how about you say single payer?
I'm jealous.
And then these people,
I wish I could be out in the sun.
So let's try this out here in the sun. Single payer? Healthcare! Single payer?
Healthcare!
All right, we'll just cheer now. We'll just... So, next up, we have a cool guy by the name of Matt Reddy. He wrote this book here. He's an author, an advocate for single-payer healthcare, and I think we're all advocates for single-payer healthcare, but... You got the right idea! I think we're all advocates for single-payer healthcare! So Matt's gonna come up and talk to you guys, and let's make sure he knows that we're glad he's here.
Alright, well, thank you so much for coming out today and allowing me to speak. I got some things to say that my wife says I'm crazy to say here, but here we go. So I'm an elected politician. I'm a hospital commissioner in Jefferson County, Washington. But more importantly, I'm an activist. I marched with Occupy Wall Street. I went to two Occupy Wall Street national gatherings. I facilitated general assemblies for them. I sat on the streets of Hong Kong during their umbrella revolution, where they were demanding real democracy. I host a podcast, I've written this book. I'm trying to figure out how to build consensus in the world, and I've got this project called the Global Consensus Project, where I'm trying to do that. And yes, I'm a diehard advocate for single-payer healthcare in this country, either at the state or federal level. Either of those could work. Our world is changing fast, and it needs your help. Who here considers themselves an activist? Just raise your hand. Great. We are entering a time where every one of us needs to be an activist. But we need, I think, a new type of activist. We need to be more thoughtful, creative, patient, open-minded, and willing to learn and grow than ever before. Is that you? Well, let's see. Who here voted for Donald Trump? Not a single hand, okay. I want to say to anyone who did vote for Donald Trump or supports President-elect Donald Trump, I want to promise you, you are not my enemy. You are my countrymen, you're my neighbors. I want you to show up and share your ideas. I want us to learn from one another, and I want to believe if Trump supporters were here, they would feel safe raising their hand, because we believe in dialogue. I hope we're all willing to say that, to welcome people with different backgrounds and radically different worldviews into our circle. I know it's easier to only speak with people of like minds, but the pathway to the world we want is not easy. Who here wants a healthcare system in which every person in the U.S. has equal access and amazing healthcare services at an affordable cost? Did we have that under Obamacare? No, not by a long shot. Obamacare is a deeply flawed law attempting to improve a deeply flawed healthcare system. It was flawed because big corporations were at the negotiating table writing the law. What the hell, people? Why are we allowing for-profit corporations to write our laws?
What the hell?
The reason is we allow them to divide us. If we, the people, want to take back control of our country, we need to unite. We need to bring all the people to the negotiating table. And corporations are not people, so they don't come to the negotiating table. Corporations are an abstract concept we use in service to us, the people. Corporations are our slaves. We all need to begin remembering this fact. Our healthcare system is an absurd mess. It's an embarrassment in the Western world. Our healthcare costs us twice as much per person as other countries, and we do not guarantee universal access, and we have worse health outcomes. We need radical transformation of our healthcare system, and to accomplish radical change, we need to do things differently. We need to elect different types of leaders. Well, we did that. I mean, it's not the type of leader we thought we'd get, but this is a different type of leader. This is a different time. And we need to stop demonizing people who we need to work with. We need to come together in ways we never have before, and that means listening. Donald Trump is not our enemy. Trump supporters are not the enemy. If you want to know who the enemy is in the struggle for universal health care, it is the for-profit corporations that relentlessly attack and block the idea of universal health care. Anyone who values their personal profits over collaborating for the good of all, that is a potential enemy. Any politician beholden to big money and corporate power is an enemy. But I don't think that is necessarily Donald Trump. Donald Trump is a maniac. He is not beholden to anyone. His independence and his courage may make him useful to us. Maniacs can be amazing allies. Give me 30 minutes talking to Donald Trump. I think I can make him a single-payer advocate.
Go for it.
After all, the road to peace is through sitting down at a table with your former enemies, breaking bread, negotiating, and signing a peace treaty so they become allies. Let us bring our enemies to the table. Let us transform our enemies into allies. Let us march in the streets demanding our government work for the good of all people and not be a tool for the wealthy elite. The pathway to a better world is open to us if we allow ourselves to be patient, thoughtful, and creative in our tactics. As I've said, I've marched with Occupy Wall Street, I've marched with unions, I've sat on the streets of Hong Kong, I've run for political office, I've written a book. I'm searching for the right tactics to help us transform our world. If you're searching to, I invite you to join me. I'm trying something new. I'm going to be hosting an open online general assembly, open to everyone, trying to create a safe space where, yes, Trump supporters and non-Trump supporters and socialists and whoever else wants to come out, we can dialogue and figure out how to unite as a people, because we need to be united. We need to start building bridges with our neighbors. Anyone who wants to work with me to figure out how to do this, please reach out to me. If you want your voice to be heard, I'm actually recording an episode of my podcast, The Mindful Activist, right now. You can come over to me after the rally and you can have your voice heard, and shared with the world. If we the people learn how to unite, we cannot be stopped. We cannot be manipulated or controlled. Let us work together to build a better world. Thank you.
I'm kind of shivering now. Are you guys shivering? So next up we have for you Timothy Baumgartner, a disabled veteran and a National Bernie delegate who's going to come share his story with y'all. So I appreciate that you're all here listening and braving the cold. And sorry, got a quick reminder, announcement. There was a medical bracelet that was dropped. If you're missing your medical bracelet, it is at the desk upstairs. Now welcome Tim.
Someone asked me a little more than a year ago to participate in a revolution. And I gotta tell you, prior to that, I was pretty much in my bedroom suffering from the effects of my PTSD and other medical issues related to my service. All I can tell you is that as a disabled American veteran and the father of an Iraq war veteran, I sometimes wonder why my cat had better health care than I did. I also want you to know that as the ACA doesn't help me, because I can't buy unsubsidized health care because I'm covered by the VA that's not functioning correctly for everyone. Some of my friends get good health care through the VA. Some of us don't. It depends on where you live, and the resources are quite stressed. All I can tell you is that each and every person here can do something in 2017 and beyond. They can keep the pressure going, become activists, get out here, get involved. You know, it's easy for us to get together and go, woohoo, let's do something. But it's a lot tougher to stay involved when the times get tough, because you see, this is a war. It's a war against the people who run this country, and it's the rich people. Not the regular folks who are just struggling from paycheck to paycheck, trying to figure out how they're going to take care of daycare, take care of medical issues, elderly people struggling to pay for their prescriptions to decide whether I'm going to get my medicine or get my heat. You know, I'm from Alaska. You know, I came down here in 2013 and retired. You know, got married. You know, this is a great place. I love the people here. It reminds me a lot of home, except for a little bit more to do. I want some folks to know something. Healthcare is a human right. There is no reason. There is no reason. I owned medical clinics, so maybe I'm one of those corporate people who understands this all too well. I made a ton of money, more money than I could spend. And I gotta tell you something, I just walked away from it. I walked away from it because, you know something, all that money wouldn't fix what's going on in this society. We have a responsibility, my friends. We just have a serious responsibility. And that's not to be so tied up in the material things, but be tied up in what's important to us as a people. Woo! You know, whether you're a Republican or a socialist or a Democrat, you're still a human. We all have a responsibility here. Everybody that's here today, I thank you. As a disabled American veteran, I'd like to say that I'm standing here for those who gave their all. People I served with, whose pieces and parts I put in bags. We have to do something about the behavior of our nation and its people. We have to come together, even in things that don't seem to make a lot of sense or times that we don't feel like we should be getting along. You know, are we stronger together? I'd like to think that we could come together. could come together, whether we agree or disagree on whatever issue it might be, and take a common sense approach. You know, my wife is from, her family's from Norway, and I think if anybody understands what that means, she's from Scandinavia, her family, and they don't have to worry about whether their elderly are going to be taken care of because they take care of everyone. I'm from Alaska, so I'm driving through Canada, I have a toothache. They don't ask me where I'm from or who I am, they pay for it. We have to take a common sense approach. If we continue to allow our electeds, Cantwell, Patty Murray, or any of these people that represent us in this state, to say that we shouldn't be bringing down the cost of medicine, then we're going to continue to fail ourselves. And I'm not going to support anyone in the future. Anyone. It's the same reason I wrote Bernie in on my ballot. Because there was nobody else for me to vote for. No, I appreciate each and every one of you, and we can agree to disagree on a lot of issues. But you know something? I went to the national DNC convention, and I took care of the people in the ACA section. Asked the delegates that were there. I took money out of my own pocket to buy pizza and water and help take care of these folks. And you know something? These folks weren't being taken care of. There were people pushed out in the hallways in wheelchairs. There was no room for them, but the millionaires and the billionaires and the politicians up in those great suites at that made-for-television event, they wouldn't let nobody in. They wouldn't let nobody in. Rick Larson was there, and I asked him, I said, hey, buddy, can you help us out? He's my representative. And he couldn't get it done, and if a congressman can't get it done, then who can? We can. It is our responsibility as human beings to come together collectively. There's got to be a coalition. We cannot continue to agree to disagree forever because in the end we get nothing done. We fail ourselves, we fail our neighbors, and you know, quite frankly, I'm not going to fail my family. My son, my oldest son, served in Iraq. He called me in 2008. I'll not ever forget this. And he said to me, Father, he says, I killed a small child and a young boy. He says, am I going to be okay? Well, he's struggling now to get his due, his mental health care, his everything. But quite frankly, friends, it's not easy to do. 7 years he's been waiting to get his disability? 7 years? How long does he have to wait? When are we going to take care of our soldiers? When are we going to take care of the people who have mental health disorders? I have to tell you, there's got to be something more than just empathy here. This is not just empathy. If you are working someplace and you get injured, you usually have something called workman's comp. I know I paid for it for over 20 years for my employees. All I can tell you is this. If we do not treat everyone with the equality or equity that they deserve as it relates to health care on all levels, we're going to continue to fail ourselves as a nation. Now, I would encourage all of you to participate in this year, 2017. Do I have anybody here who would disagree with me when I say it's our responsibility to come together as a people and say enough is enough?
Enough is enough! 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 Enough is enough!
That's it. I can't hear you. Is enough enough?
Enough is enough! Enough is enough!
You know, there's a nice lady standing behind me here. Her name is Barbara Ullman. And she helped us to get these t-shirts to wear at the convention. I gotta tell you, when we walked out the first time on Tuesday, the second day of the convention, all these Sanders delegates, hundreds and hundreds of us walked out in protest. What were we greeted by? Do you have any idea? Well, I'm going to tell you what we were greeted by. We were greeted by people with machine guns.
Snipers.
Snipers. This is what we were greeted by. I don't know if any of you know it. I was there. And these kids were scared. Okay? And you know something? This isn't what politics is supposed to be about. It's not what our nation is supposed to be about. We're just neighbors who love one another, who care about each other. But you know something, quite frankly, we're being run by folks who apparently have an agenda that I can't afford to even buy. You know? And you know something, if we don't change the direction, I gotta tell you, we outnumber the rich. We outnumber them. We outnumber them. And quite frankly, my father was not a real good man. But he had this silly thought in his mind that, you know, if folks didn't realize that there was more of them than there was of more of him than there was of them, that he could just take what he wanted in life. Well, I don't recommend we just take it. I don't. But I do recommend that we say to folks, listen, this is just about living. It's just about being alive and being kind and caring and considerate. When you walk by your neighbor, don't you wave and say hello? You know, in Alaska, that's how we do it. If it's cold and someone's broke down on the road, it's against the law to pass them. You know, here in Washington, I see people, you wave at them and they go, oh, they get a little afraid. And the further south, the further south you go, they get even more afraid, you know? And listen, I want to thank you people for coming here today. I want you all to know how much I appreciate it. Because, you know, I serve this country and I see you serving this country today. I see you people ready to get it done. So let's do it. 2017 is the beginning of a new revolution. And I want Bernie Sanders to be proud of the fact that we came here today. Thank you.
I think Tim hit a really good point. We should give ourselves a round of applause for being out here today. I mean, give yourselves a real round of applause for being out here today. Just want to remind you guys to sign up for more events like these. You can go to savehealthcare.us, not .com, .us. And next, we're going to have for you Leslie Zucker, who is the Secretary of the Washington State Democrats Disabilities Issues Caucus, as well as a member of Healthcare for All Washington and the Healthcare is a Human Right Coalition. She was a Bernie Sanders delegate at the National Convention, and she has the coolest...
What?
State Convention, sorry. And she had the coolest onesie I've ever seen in my entire life. So, let's give her a round of applause.
Hi, my name is Leslie Zucker, and I'm the Secretary of the Washington State Democrats Disabilities Issues Caucus. When I was a freshman in college, I suffered a breakdown and joined the ranks of the chronically ill. To maintain a semblance of normalcy, medication and weekly therapist and psychiatrist visits were prescribed. But I quickly found out that the for-profit insurance companies would do whatever they could to cover as little as possible. At first, they wouldn't even cover my mental health care, and my prescriptions were only paid for at 50%. Then I incurred a misfortune of fate. Cheaper medications did not work, and my body refused to respond to most generics as it did to brand name drugs. But I, thankfully, as an accident of fate, I was born into a fairly wealthy family, and my family could afford for a while to pay for my medical care, which cost some $40,000 a year. But as a result of 13 years of chronic illness, my family's savings began to dwindle. The more legislators tried to level the playing field for the most vulnerable, the more ways my insurance company would devise to skirt new laws, all in the name of profits. Under Obamacare, Regents sold me a non-existent policy and then refused to honor it. My dad pleaded, "She'll be in the hospital if you don't cover her medications." The response from Regents on a recorded line, "Well, then let her go to the hospital."
Boo.
To even get full coverage from Regents for 1 year, we had to threaten to get the state insurance commissioner involved. Thankfully, there were other options. Since I became disabled before Social Security defined adulthood, I was eligible for Medicare. After a protracted process, I received my benefits, and I quickly found out the government-run insurance was far more efficient and far more cost-effective than what I could get on the private market. Thanks to Medicare Part D and extra government help for people with disabilities, my prescription drugs were covered at nearly 100%, instead of the 15% they would have been had I remained on private insurance. The only hurdle to my receiving full coverage was that the U.S. is not a single-payer nation, and that my mental health professionals refused to accept Medicare. Instead of working toward Medicare for all and ensuring full coverage, our Republican Congress has other ideas. Under Speaker Ryan's Medicare privatization scheme, I shudder to think where that leaves me. I and other disabled Americans and our seniors simply cannot buy insurance on the private market for the cost of our Medicare premiums. In short, I would be left in the cold, as just one of my 10 prescriptions costs $2,800 a month, and I have serious doubts about how much a private insurance company would pay. To be frank, the health savings accounts touted by Republicans are none other than a death sentence for those like me with chronic illness. What if a family crisis culminates in my mental instability and I need to be hospitalized? Since my breakdown 13 years ago, I've developed hypothyroidism, irritable bowel syndrome, and asthma on top of my mental health conditions. Should I have to choose between my physical health and my mental health if Medicare decides that I only get a fixed dollar voucher for my coverage?
No!
As it is, too many Americans have to choose between food on the one hand and healthcare on the other. How many people have to perish before everyone realizes that Paul Ryan's privatization plan is merely a giveaway to the insurance companies?
Yes,
I got you.
Truthfully, the reality is that I personally would survive the privatization of Medicare, at least in the short term. My parents still have some, albeit much less savings, and we live only a few hours away from the Canadian border, where I can buy the exact same prescriptions for one-tenth the price that were actually manufactured here at home in the United States.
Oh.
The problem is that most people in my situation do not have the same luxuries. If I were born into poverty, I simply would not be alive today. I would not have the means to see the best doctors, get the most cutting-edge prescriptions, and receive the best therapy. The bottom line is that without services such as Medicare, as they exist today, those who have chronic mental illnesses like myself would be shut out. And who would live and who might tragically decide to take their own life would be at the whim of our family's wealth. I would implore our legislators to preserve and strengthen Medicare and to move toward a single-payer system where people with disabilities, people like me, can live in dignity. Thank you. Medicare for all!
Thank you.
Thank you guys for hanging out. We only have a few more speakers left. You guys are really brave, because I know I'm back here pacing, trying to get warm. Somebody just said you passed your shiver on to me. I don't think I'm to blame for that, okay? Anyway, next up for you, we have Jace Turner. Jace is a transmasculine two-spirit water protector and a trans healthcare activist. So please give Jace a big round of applause.
People are already dying. My kin are dying. My trans and two-spirit siblings. There were several suicides shortly after the election within circles of my friends. Us, like six people in Texas in my one friend's circle in a matter of a week, gone. And it's because we're scared that this would happen. I was homeless for 5 years. And I went to San Francisco, actually, because at the time, that's the only place I could get healthcare. And gentrification pushed a bunch of queer people out of San Francisco. And I came up here. And for a while, I didn't have healthcare. 3 years ago, I went over my handlebars on my bike at a major intersection in Portland. And for the last, 4 years, actually, for the last 4 years, I've been living with several dislocated ribs. And part of the reason for that is the ER doctor didn't know how to make me feel comfortable enough to take my binder off of my chest at the time so I could feel like he was going to respect me while he was checking my ribs out. And only after I saw a trans doctor did I get a diagnosis for these dislocated ribs last month. This is pain that people typically only have to deal with for several hours until their ribs are reset at the ER. Trans inclusive healthcare saves lives, but it's got to be more expansive than just hormone replacement therapy and gender confirming surgery. It's got to include the dignity of trans people, how to respect us and allow us to receive the care that we need, that we desperately need. There's a genocide happening, and it's happening against trans people right now. There's a 500 some odd plus year genocide happening also against indigenous people that has not stopped. It has been continuous. And if this is not an attempt to expand that genocide, I don't know what it is. My grandma was, one of my grandmothers was Cherokee and Blackfoot, and another one of my grandmothers was Welsh. The Welsh people have not been successfully colonized. They've retained their culture, their language, even though many people have tried to colonize them. My grandma was a nurse in World War II. When I was 9 years old, I asked her dire questions about the war and what led to the rise of Hitler taking power. And she told me that I needed to prepare, because she saw that in 30 or 40 years, hasn't been that long, that we would forget. Because that we will forget what gave rise to Hitler. Because it's a human cycle that we keep repeating. And like all abusive cycles, they can and must be stopped. Yeah. We have to stop it. We have the power. The people are the power.
The people are the power, isn't that the truth? Jennifer's got it. The people are the power, is that right? Are the people the power? Who has the power in their hands? We do! So next up we have Dr. Sherry Barrett, and she is a physician who has worked with veterans, and she herself is disabled, and she has a very special personal story to share with you all. So please give her a huge warm welcome.
Hello, I'm Dr. Sherry Barrett. My family first came to Olympia 56 years ago because my father was a pediatrician to give health care to the children of Olympia. I've had a lot of experience in this, as well as needing health care myself. And I've always been against our health care system with its bits and pieces here and there. Some things I would like to talk about. We have a lot of age discrimination in our health care. Right now, my children are on CHIP, Children's Health Insurance Program, and I can get care for them very quickly. But my son, who's on the autistic spectrum, I don't know what's going to happen to him in a year and 4 months when he turns 19 and is no longer eligible for this program. While he was on the government program, he broke his hip while he was at Boy Scout camp, and we were able to get health care quickly and efficiently, and his hips are well now. He could have become extremely disabled if we did not have that coverage. I've had a lot of examples of the problems with this age discrimination in our healthcare. One is, I was once a resident in Arkansas. I had one patient who at age 19 was in a bad car accident with a head injury. Without health care, he was destined to live in a nursing home and die young. Because the Arkansas Children's Hospital was willing to take him, he received rehab and a rehab session. He received rehab services and later went on to college for a much more, how do we put it, for a life where he was likely to make money and make a contribution to our society again. I had a 23-year-old who had a condition where she was in the ICU for several months due to an overwhelming infectious disease. Because she was over the 21-year-old age limit,
yeah, he works with my husband. I don't know if you knew that.
Discharge her to a nursing home where she was likely to not get any rehabilitation services and therefore, again, to die young in a nursing home. Now I'm age 55 and I'm on Medicare, and I can't get the same services that my age 65-year-old friends can get on the same health care. And I can't understand why these plans are different for under age 65 versus over age 65. Why does this matter? Well, it all comes down to we're for profit. And because there's a lot of people age 65 and older who have a lot of money, the insurance tries to cater to them. And if you're someone who doesn't have a lot of money or under age 65, and they assume that under age 65 you don't have money because you became disabled young in life, the services don't cater to them. I worked for DSHS. DSHS, we delivered very good care. We didn't worry about who was paying us at all. That was not part of my daily routine. All I did was give health care to people with developmental disabilities. Then I was living up in Buckley. It started to fall apart when they wanted me to work not only my 8 to 5, but also to work on weekends and holidays. And I had a son, age 11, over here. And when I had him, I needed a great deal of health care, and I couldn't work. I wasn't allowed to work for about 7 months. And so when I came back to work, what happened is I caught the flu while I was pregnant, and that had done a number on my heart, which is why I wasn't able to work. I'd worked using a scooter my whole life as a physician. I was born with a type of joint disease, which gives me early arthritis. Anyway, when I came back, they wanted me to work so much. My mother broke her hip soon thereafter, and while she was in the hospital for 4 or 5 weeks, I was on call 70% of the days. So essentially they said, you know, if you're gonna have a baby, you're expected to come back and work an overwhelming amount. Kind of the consequence of a system where we look at how much you're able to produce rather than the fact that when you have a baby, maybe you can't work as much. Therefore, I retired. Because I was able to retire, I had had a disability since age 25. So I came back to Olympia, and I wanted to set up a practice again, but I myself, as a doctor, could not get health care. The physicians in Olympia could not afford to take Medicare, and so the rheumatologist would not see me and get paid Medicare wages. So we have problems with our system where there's this constant push-pull. I also worked for the VA. I was very happy as a VA physician. The rehab program, we were considered one of the highest functioning units at the VA. We had a system where we had 30 beds. Our department controlled 30 beds. So if someone had a stroke or lost a leg or was in a car accident, we got to choose who came into our healthcare system. We did not choose by how we would make money. Money was not the issue. We were given a system where we had this many beds, this many nurses, this many physical therapists, this many occupational therapists, this many psychologists. And the physicians, how did we choose who came in? We had a waiting list that was over a year long. We chose by who we could help the most. There was nobody telling us, you know, well, you do this one. You know, when I was a doctor in private practice, someone on Medicaid got this service, someone on LNI got this service, someone on Medicare got this service. It made no sense. It was all due to, in private practice, who had the best health care. Just like my rheumatologist couldn't see me. Now, when I was on a private health care paid for as a state employee, he could see me. But as soon as I was switched over to Medicare, he couldn't see me anymore, when in reality it meant that I was sicker from my arthritis. So, what I'm trying to say is our current system isn't making sense. Another thing that happened when I was a doctor in private practice is Regents would say they would pay for a procedure that I did, and you would jump through all the hoops to get it done. You got okay by primary care physician. But Regents would come back and say, after they had promised they would pay for it, they would come back and say, well, that wasn't medically necessary, if we're not going to pay for it. And you couldn't make any money, even though to deliver the health care cost you $300. And this is what's happening to physicians in Olympia. The orthopedic surgeons they shared with me, yeah, they do it with surgeries too. Mine was a small procedure where I tested people's nerves. Theirs would be a big procedure, say like a joint replacement. And Regents would say they were going to pay for this procedure. And then after the doctor had done the procedure, went through every hoop, Regents would say that it wasn't medically necessary. So realize now, they're one of the most powerful insurance companies in Washington State. This was 20 years ago. So we have a system now where if the insurance company is very frugal and makes decisions that don't make sense, then they make more profits and they become more wealthy. If it's an insurance company that does what's right, they're not as likely to make money. So we've seen a lot of insurance companies in Washington State fall by the wayside. I believe the only way we can come over this is to pay for health care like we pay for schools. Haven't we all gone to public schools? I did. I went to Lincoln Elementary and Capitol High School in Boston Harbor. Taxpayers paid for it willingly, and I did extremely well because of it. I always think I was so lucky that I was in a city that paid for education. Why can't we do that for health care? Why is healthcare, which is even more basic than education, being controlled by people for profit? Our schools aren't for profit. So why are our hospitals? It doesn't make sense.
Hospitals do write off a certain amount of debt. You know, they can kind of turn the other cheek for some people.
Healthcare, like education, a basic right of everybody who lives in America. If you're living inside our borders, you should be able to go to a hospital and get the care that you need without it keeping you out of your home or unable to feed your children. And that's every example is what I'm thinking we need to do. Thank you.
I didn't realize there was quite a boom amongst 20-somethings. I mean, people are having kids later and later.
All right, guys, we're at the tail end here. We only got two more speakers. Matthew, where are you going? You better not be leaving. Oh, yeah, I caught you. That's right. So next, we have Jennifer Gigi Ferguson. She is a substance abuse therapist. I think that's the right word, right? Okay, close enough. She's a great speaker, and I love her to death, and she's going to speak to you guys, so get ready.
Okay, he left off one. I'm also a marriage and family therapist. And I have a husband who is a Vietnam veteran.
Yeah, no IVF or anything.
I lost a mother to cancer when I was 7.5 years old in Chicago. And I lost her to cancer 6 months after she was diagnosed because we didn't have appropriate health care. Recently, we've lost a friend of the family to diabetes because she couldn't afford the Affordable Care Act, and she couldn't afford what they had prior to that. So her only availability of medication was when she would go into the hospital and what they would give her when she left. This is not acceptable. This is not acceptable. The Affordable Care Act is a beginning. It is not the end all. Social Security was the beginning. They built on Social Security for years to get it to where it is. Why have the Democrats and Republicans not worked to build on Social Security, on the Affordable Care Act, versus trying to take it down? It tells me you and I are not their first priority. It's obvious if you know something is not right and you don't fix it, then it's not a priority for you. I say single payer health care for all. I stand for single payer health care for all. My heart on what all has been done with the Affordable Care Act. It has helped so many people, but there's so many people it has hurt. My husband's a Vietnam vet. He came in when they told us health care was for life. No one told us when he turned 65, he could go to the VA, which I won't allow, but his regular medical, the military no longer picked up as a second payer. He has to get Social Security in order to get the second part. That's ridiculous. And we didn't know it. So when I finally got him to start doing tests, we ended up paying a lot out of our pockets. That does not work for me. Does it work for you?
No.
Why are our seniors being attacked? Why? They have the wisdom, they have the knowledge to teach us. Yet they're being thrown aside, kicked to the curb, and treated as if they are no one. They are someone. They're your mother and my grandmother and someone else's grandmother. They are people we love. We need single payer health care, and we need it now. Stories I've heard as I've campaigned across Washington, and it irks me to hear seniors tell me I'm eating cat food and dog food to pay for my medication, or not eating at all. Is that acceptable?
No.
Would you want to eat cat food or dog food?
No.
Maybe when I go to DC this March, I'll take our senators and congressmen some cat food and dog food.
Paul Ryan!
Maybe I'll just mail Paul Ryan his.
Hey.
But I do have people that I will be going with that will personally meet with Paul Ryan, and I'll make sure to give them some cat food and dog food and ask him to have it for lunch.
I like her.
Oh, you know what? I'll see if I can get him to do that on camera. I'd love to see his face. And Paul Ryan does meet with our organization. Now, I will also be in Catwell's office and Murray's office.
Yeah.
We'll not get to see them, but I will make sure on camera that we give them some their aids, some cat food, and some dog food. I've also heard, see, they have to see me because I belong to an organization that was founded in 1913 with college women on Howard campus. The first thing we did was march in the Women's Suffrage March in 1913. I marched in the reenactment of the Women's Suffrage March in 2013. We have over 250,000 educated black women who are in this organization. And when we speak on Capitol Hill and we show up on Capitol Hill, they know we're there.
Woo-hoo!
I am determined to not give up the fight. I am determined to stay on the front line. I did it for TPP. I did it for No DAPL. And I'm going to do it for healthcare. I am the people's politician.
Yeah.
And I am going to take on Cantwell so that we can have someone representing Washington State who is not owned by corporate America.
Yeah.
We need people who care about people. Coming out of the projects of Chicago, losing my mom, partially being homeless after she died, I'm sorry, I'm not for sale. I'm not for sale. We need to keep this up. I need your help. We need your help. We need you to stay involved. We need you to be in the fight. And everyone that you know that has given up because Bernie did not win, you need to get them back. We need to get them back. Just because you don't win a seat does not mean you lost. It just means you can use your mouth a little bit longer without having to worry about the establishment. And that's what we need. That is what we're getting. And we need you to stay with us. I am Jennifer Gigi Ferguson. I am one of you. And I am pushing to make sure we get Medicaid, medical for all. Single payer. Let's take care of our kids. Let's take care of our adults. Let's take care of our seniors. Let's take care of our disabilities. Let's take care of America first. Thank you.
How's everybody feeling? We still hanging in there? About 15 more minutes. We can handle that?
Yeah! A couple toes will fall off.
Can we handle that?
Yeah!
So I was hoping that I could share my story with you all, if that's okay. Oh, I heard like six people say okay.
Tell us, Eric.
So, healthcare has been an integral part of my life. The fact that I'm even here right now, at least three times in my life, is because of free healthcare. I was born with a rare birth defect that causes blood clots in my face that caused me to be hard of hearing, which
was fixed simply because of surgery, but until my mom was able to obtain free healthcare for me, I had to live 12 years of my life clinically deaf. When I was 23, I was diagnosed with melanoma, which is a form of skin cancer. And again, if it was not for free or low-cost healthcare, I may not be here today. Just 2 years ago, my right lung collapsed. My left lung also had a pneumothorax, which in medical terms basically means it was collapsed too. And the doctors pretty much told me that if I had gone home and gone to sleep that night, that I may not have woken up. So I definitely understand the importance of healthcare. I look at my son, and I'm not exactly rich, so I worry sometimes. Right now, he has healthcare. But when he's 18 or 25 or 30 or 40, is he still gonna have that healthcare? What happens if he's diagnosed with melanoma? What happens if his lung collapses and no one's there to treat him? What happens if your children or your grandchildren or your brothers or sisters have a fatal condition and there's no healthcare there for them? It seems so simple. If someone's sick, they should have the right to be treated. So why is there so much pushback? Why doesn't everybody see it as simple as this? Why aren't we born with the right to free healthcare? Why do we even have to be here today fighting for the right to live? Why has this system been created that someone can make money off of my illness? Why does the fact that my son has seizures mean that somebody else gets money in their pockets?
Yes.
Why is that senior citizen trying to figure out how she can pay her rent and get her prescriptions?
Yes.
Every month?
Yes.
Every month for 20 years, I just heard somebody say that.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
No more.
That's sick.
No more.
That's the reason they're eating.
Why do I go without my EpiPen? Because I can't afford it? You know, I don't bring this up because I'm worried, because, you know, I figured it out, but the fact that I have to figure it out, the fact that I have to roll that dice, the fact that I have to take the chance and choose not to pay for it, that is the issue. Because my life matters. Each and every one of you, your life matters. It does not matter the color of your skin, your orientation, your nationality, where you have come from, or who you vote for. You deserve health care. Do not let anybody tell you something different. So keep fighting. This is just our first step.
Yes.
And leave here today and tell somebody else that may not have known about this fight. Educate your community, because we are on the front lines. We are the key to healthcare for all. Thank you so much for being here today. We have one more speaker for you. So if you hold on for just a moment, we only got a couple more minutes here. Mariana Everson, who is a nurse and an organizer for Democracy Rising, would like to say a few things.
I don't care what your socioeconomic status is. I don't care your race, your age, your sexual identity. I will take care of you. Because that's what I do. I am a nurse.
Thank you.
I want our dollars to go to paying for health care. I want our dollars to pay for hospitals. I want our dollars to pay for doctors. I want our dollars to pay for medications. I want our dollars to pay for nurses. I do not want our dollars to pay for insurance companies. very simply, single payer health care. It is time. Yeah.
What was that?
Peanut gallery.
My prayers have been answered. You're like the UK Parliament.
Yes. Yes. We are all making sacrifices. You are all making sacrifices for being here today. That guy. He is making more money. And you see, this is why these events are so important. And so, before we close today, I know I did it once before, but please give yourselves a round of applause.
I don't have insurance.
You are the ones who will lead the future. And I gotta say that I feel very blessed to have such a great community of people who are out here fighting for things that should just be common sense. So thank you all. Thank you for coming. Please visit savehealthcare.us if you want to go to more events like this. There's people with sign-up sheets and stuff for other things if you want to get active. So if you're interested, do that. But thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Are you working on or? No judgment, I'm just scared.